superhuman.
I'm not superhuman.
Someone save me from the haze.
It's just another war. Just another family torn.
Today, to live another day, speaking my mind today.
My voice will be heard today.
I've gotta make a stand, but I am just a man.
I'm not superhuman.
My voice will be heard today. It's just another war, just another family torn.
My voice will be heard today.
It's just another kill. The countdown begins to destroy us.
I'm emotional. Whew. There's something about baptisms when people just make sure that there's a next step. I just become a big baby. I'm already a big baby as it is, but I become a bubbling big baby. So, but again, my name is Ronnie. I'm the lead pastor here. If this is your very first time at Calvary Church, we would just want to say welcome. We are glad that you're here, and we want to journey alongside you. We are family here. And so if you would, please fill out that connection card. We want to connect with you. We want to get to know you. When the service is over, like they said, you know, meet us in the back in our Calvary Cafe. We have a goodie, some goodies for you. But more importantly, we just want to connect. We are not meant to do life alone. And so we want to connect with you. As they said, the ladies have decades and dice. They're going to be playing some games. They're going to be fellowshipping. Childcare is provided. Also, the Royal Rangers had their cardboard regatta yesterday. And apparently they did okay. Nobody drowned because we had plenty of life jackets and oars. And so I thank you for everybody who donated some life jackets. I believe they had 12 kids that were involved in it. And I think all the boats sank. Well, one made it. Who made it? Two made it. Who made it? Nice. Next year we're going to have 20 boats and 19 are going to make it. Because I'm going to get one and it'll sink. But before we dive into today's message, I want to do something real quick. This person is not going to like me for what I'm about to do, but Ryan Bradle, come on up here. We are wrapping up our villain series today, and this young man has been doing all of our artwork and all of our video work. And so he is not a big fan of attention. He's not a big fan of doing anything, but I want to say thank you. You have made this sermon series come to life with videos like this. So I went out and I got you a little gift to kind of continue to help you with your art stuff. You don't have to open it in front of everybody. So, but thank you. So, and he is for hire. If you need something, see, I'll pitch it for you, make some money. All right. He's getting close to 16. He needs a car. So, if you know, he does portraits. He does all types of things, you know. So, but thank you, Ryan. We're all going to stare at you until you sit down. No, I really appreciate Ryan because he really has done a great job of just bringing this to life. And it's amazing to see young people using their gifts for God. And, you know, it's just there's something about young people. They were up here worshiping. They just came back from camp in 2 weeks. They're going to be sharing what took. Oh, I'm going to cry again. Because I'm going to tell you something. When kids get on fire, it changes us. The Bible says that they're the example. I'm not even in my sermon yet, but they're the example. Y'all are supposed to set the example. Y'all are supposed to worship the way that you worship. You're supposed to show us old people what it's like, because at one time we were like y'all, but we let the world get to us and let it kill that fire inside of us. So do not let the world kill that. Use each other. Talk to each other. Come together and continue to grow and show these old people, I'm one of them, what it means to truly love God and to worship God. And I want to see you guys change your community, change your friends, change your school, and begin to be the light that God has called you to be. So if you want, inside your bulletins now, I'm going to start preaching. There are some note sections. Feel free to follow along. You know, if you need a pen, there are pens all across the room on the different tables. But like I said, we are going to be wrapping up our villain series today. And I said this before, that this has probably been one of my top two series, because it has just been so hard hitting. It has been at times where we have stepped on each other's toes, where it's been a little bit in our face. But I believe that God is beginning to do something within our church, that we begin to overcome the obstacles and the villains that are in our lives. So I'm a little sad that it's wrapping up, but you know, every good superhero movie has a sequel. So I don't know if down the road we may have a sequel to this. We may have Villains 2, where we talk about Voldemort, where we talk about Lord Farquaad from Shrek, and we talk about Wreck-It Ralph. You know, there may be a time where we come up and we talk about some of these other things that are coming our way. But one of the things about this series is that there is an enemy that is real, and that is the thing that we want to be talking about and what we've been focusing on. But when we think about spiritual things, we have this idea that it's just this crazy thing that happens here. But what I've been trying to do is show you that the spiritual attacks that you have are real and that they're tangible. They're tangible through some of the villains of conflict or the critical spirit or deception. And you know, and I appreciate, I got a little bit of an echo, so pull me out of the monitors. I appreciate, you know, last week Gabriel too came in and he spoke. And I tell you, I listened to the sermon. One of the things that blessed me was to hear him talk about the environment that he walked into. I am appreciative of Mark, who is out there in the parking lot. And this is why I went to church on Sunday in Fayetteville. This church was a friend of mine. The pastor was a friend of mine. Let me tell you, I walked from the parking lot to my seat, listened to the whole sermon, and then from my seat to the parking lot, not one person greeted me. See, that is not an environment that I want at Calvary Church. That is why I am so persistent and I'm so passionate about saying we need connectors. We need people that are willing to get into the parking lot and sweat it out for the glory of God. Because I'm telling you, it changes the atmosphere. So if you are looking for a place to get involved and to serve, we got a place for you. We got a badge for you. We got a spot for you, because we believe here that served people serve people. That's sermon number two. Now we're going to get into sermon number three. We've been talking about villains, and the reality is that every villain has a hero. There is somebody that is combating what that villain is doing. See, a villain is all about destroying, distracting, and dividing the world, where the hero wants to come in and he wants to bring about unity and wants to bring it together. And so this morning, as we wrap up this series, I want to talk about what it takes to be a hero. And so I'm going to run through six different points, and then I've got another mini-series. Man, I got a lot of sermons in this thing. I was telling the team this morning, I wrote two sermons, and I condensed them in one, so I drank two Red Bulls so I could talk really, really fast and get them both in here in 30 minutes. So that's why we record it, so you can go back and watch it, because I'm going to be talking really fast today. But the first way, or the first thing that it takes to be a hero, is to recognize this, that a villain is bad, and a hero is good. Mind-boggling, isn't it? That was just like an epiphany for people. No, the reality is that the enemy is bad and God is good. And in this walk after Christ, there are going to be bad things that come against us. There are going to be things that try to distract us, that try to discourage us. And so over the last 2 months, we've been looking at some of those bad things. The critical spirit, the condemnation, you know, the conflict, the deception, our past, our weaknesses. We've been looking at these bad things that come our way. But if we're going to overcome them, we have to overcome them with the good things. And so if we want to be a hero, if we want to overcome the critical spirit, if we want to overcome our past that keeps beating us up, if we want to overcome the deceptive things, if we want to overcome that critical things that we deal with, the first thing we have to do is pursue after God. The Bible tells us in Matthew 6:33, the thing you should want most is God's kingdom and doing what God wants. The King James says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. See, if we were to overcome the enemy, the very first thing that we have to do is we have to establish a relationship with God. There has to be a desire to put God in his rightful place, and that is in the center of our heart. See, when you break down this scripture, it literally means two different things. It means, one, the kingdom of God simply means desiring the power and the authority and the love of Jesus into your life. If you want to overcome the things that the world has for you, you simply have to just follow after him. And then the second part of that is that you just have to pursue righteousness. In other words, do your best to do what is right. to begin to study the Word of God, to read the Word of God, to be taught the things of the Word. In Philippians 4:8, Paul is speaking and he says, "Now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true and what is honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about the things that are excellent and praiseworthy and worthy of praise. Keep putting into practice all you learn and receive from me, everything you heard from me and saw me doing." See, what I've learned in my walk after Christ is that if I want to be a hero for Christ, I begin to put into practice the things that I have been taught. I begin to put into practice the things that I have studied on my own. I begin to put into practice the things that God has revealed to me in His presence. See, this morning we were talking and we were singing about, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. But let me tell you something. When you're in the presence of God, life change happens. And see, if we want to be the hero that God wants us to be, if we want to overcome the villains that are in our life, we have to desire to be in His presence. We have to desire that the first thing we do in the morning is we cry out to Him. You know, there's this old book, before he went crazy, by Benny Hinn, that he said, every morning I'd wake up and I would say, "Good morning, Holy Spirit." Do you know how much your life would change if you woke up and the very first words out of your mouth was, "Good morning, Holy Spirit"? It's a recognition of Him coming first. It's the influence and the understanding that you want His presence in your life from the beginning of your day to the end of your day. See, a hero puts into practice. See, as we love God unconditionally, as we study His Word, we begin to pursue what He wants us to do. As we connect relationally in relationships, as we get into life groups, we will begin to know what to do. See, this is the beginning steps of becoming a hero. It's to separate yourself from the bad and desire the good. Number two, a villain is selfish where a hero is self-sacrificing. See, a villain is focused on one thing and one thing only, and that is themselves. The enemy is focused on one thing and one thing only, and it's himself. When it comes to a relationship with God, we have to follow the example of Christ and be self-sacrificing. See, if we're to overcome the villains of this world, if we're going to overcome the criticism, if we're going to overcome deception, if we're going to overcome our past, we have to get to a place where we are self-sacrificing. See, right now, that's uncomfortable for a lot of people in this room. It's like, man, why do I have to give up so much of myself? Because that's exactly what Jesus did. Jesus gave of Himself on the cross. While we are yet sinners, Christ showed His love by dying on the cross. If we are to overcome the things of this world, because the world is selfish, the world tells you to get what's yours and forget everybody else. The world tells you that in order to get somewhere in life, you have to tear other people down. But Jesus says, be humble as I am humble. Jesus didn't come from heaven to be served. He came to serve. See, the hero Jesus came into our lives in the mindset of being self-sacrificing, in giving of Himself. And see, we got to understand that in this life, we're going to have difficulties. One of the things that I've watched a ton of superhero movies. I love superhero movies. But in this sermon series, I've watched a whole lot more because I've watched them with this mindset of just trying to figure out some things. There is not a superhero movie that I've watched that the world, the people didn't turn against the superhero. The hero is doing everything he can to save the world, and yet these people sit on their chairs and they have this ability to criticize them, tear them down. And the same thing will happen to us in our relationship as we pursue Christ and we try to become the hero in our relationship to overcome the villain. You have to understand that the world is going to come against you. John 15 talks about it. It says, "This is my command, love each other. If the world hates you, remember that it hated me first. The world would love you as one of its own if you belong to it, but you are no longer part of the world. I chose you to come out of the world, so it hates you." Now, I love verse 27 because Jesus goes on and he's talking about the hate, and he says this, though, "And you must also testify about me because you have been with me." See, Jesus starts this off by saying the world is going to despise you. It's going to hate everything that you stand for. It's going to turn its back against you. Friends will leave you alone. They will walk away from you. And all he says, and then in the midst of all of that, in the midst of all of the criticism, in the midst of all of the turning away and the mocking and everything like that, Jesus says, "Now I want you to testify about me." If somebody was to walk up to you and smack you in the face I would not be able to look at them and say, I love you. I would not be able to look them in the face and say, thank you. But that is the very thing that a hero does. A hero in the midst of every criticism and every slander and every hurt that is coming your way because of your stance with Jesus Christ, a hero, a Christian, will stand there and turn the other cheek. But how do you get there? You get there by going back to step one, pursuing Christ and pursuing his righteousness, getting to a place of studying the word so when that slap comes, you're prepared to turn that other cheek. See, John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whosoever shall believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Christ set the example of what it means to be a hero in this world of selfishness, to be a person that is self-sacrificing, to be a person that gives of themselves in order for other people to come into a relationship. Those of you that know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, those of you that got baptized today, at one point in your life, somebody sacrificed themselves to share Jesus with you. And the Bible tells us that we are to go and do the very thing that was done for us. See, there are people in this church that are self-sacrificing. There are people that show up 2 hours before service just to prepare a nursery for your children. There are people that come here 2 hours before and they're setting up and they're sweating it out in the parking lot. And see, the reason they're willing to sweat it out in the parking lot is because they know it's about one soul coming into a relationship with Jesus Christ. And I think if we begin to become the hero where we begin to focus on the souls, we'll forget about the service. When we begin to focus on what Jesus is doing, we'll be less likely to be worried about what we're doing and how much it costs us to give. See, whatever it is, a hero will sacrifice for others. The third thing that it takes is, a villain is about the moment, where a hero is about the long term. See, the reality is that most of us will give up our eternity, will give up our inheritance, will give up our purpose in Christ for a moment. There's a story in the Bible about a set of twins, and I'll read about it real quick. It's in Genesis chapter 5. It says, one day when Jacob was cooking some stew, Esau, his brother, his twin brother, arrived home from the wilderness exhausted and hungry. Esau said to Jacob, I'm starved. Give me some of that red stew. All right, Jacob replied, but trade me your rights as the firstborn son. Look, I'm dying of starvation, said Esau. What good is my birthright to me now? But Jacob said, first you must swear that your birthright is mine. So Esau swore an oath, thereby selling all his rights as the firstborn to his brother Jacob. Back in the day, the firstborn got everything. In this moment, Esau had just come home from hunting. Any of y'all hunt? Any of y'all get hungry after you get hunting? Done hunting? I don't know, I don't hunt. I don't shoot Bambi. I will eat Bambi, but I will not shoot Bambi. Bambi's yummy. But let me ask you this. How many of y'all been so dramatic that it's like, if I don't get something to eat, I'm going to die? How many of y'all are saying that right now? Like, dude, hurry up. I'm hungry. I want to go to wherever I'm going to go. This was Esau. Esau was so hungry that he was willing to give up his full inheritance for a bowl of soup. It's like going to the Japanese restaurant and they bring out that soup and giving up everything in your life for that little bit. See, that's what a villain does. A villain focuses on the moment where a hero focuses on the long term. See, so many times we get caught up in what's going on in our lives that we focus on the physical, we focus on the moment that where God is saying, listen, focus on the spiritual, focus on the long term. This attack is just for the moment. Overcome it by focusing on me and the future. See, we get to this place when the attacks are coming, we get so overwhelmed with what's going on that we take everything personal. See, to overcome the moment, you have to remain spiritual. You have to look at the things that are coming your way as a spiritual attack, not a physical attack. See, the villain makes everything personal. Look at superhero movies. Every villain in those superhero movies, it's a personal reason why they are doing what they are doing. But the hero of the story is not focused on the personal. He's focused on the bigger picture. He has a totally different perspective than the villain. Are you hearing me on this? Some of y'all have got to stop focusing on the villain and look at the bigger picture. See what God is doing in your life. See what he's trying to teach you. See what he's trying to get you through. See, I've learned a whole lot that God doesn't always answer our prayers just to make it go away. He answers our prayers by saying, I'm walking with you through it all. But see, we get so focused on the physical thing that is going on in our lives that we forget about the spiritual. We forget about what's going on. And when the enemy comes, see, the enemy is attacking you in the physical because he recognized what's going on in the spiritual. And he's trying to change your perspective to stop viewing the spiritual, and he wants you to view on the circumstance. See, Ephesians 1, 17 and 18 says this, I ask God to make you intelligent and discerning in knowing him personally, your eyes focused and clear so that you can see exactly what he is calling you to do. Grasp the immensity of the glorious way of life he has for us. In other words, Paul is telling him, I want you to grab God's perspective in your situation. Ask God to show you what he sees, to let you see the bigger picture. See, one of the things that I've learned when it comes to dealing with individuals, and I do some one-on-one conversations. I work with some couples, and what I try to get couples to do, and even what I try to do, is I try to get everybody to step outside the personal and look at the bigger picture. See, when we begin to get the bigger picture, we stop looking at self, and then when we stop looking at self, we stop taking it personal, and we begin to move it into the spiritual, because what it's all about is not being right, it's about being reconciled. See, if you want to be a hero, you have to keep things spiritual. But how do you keep things spiritual if you're not opening up the Word of God? How do you keep things spiritual if you're not spending time in prayer? How do you keep things spiritual when you don't have the relationships that are going to strengthen and encourage you in your walk? See, we can't keep it spiritual when we isolate ourselves. When we allow ourselves to become like the villain, separate, things become personal. Number four. A villain is about power and control, where a hero is about teamwork and unity. Every villain that I know wants to dominate the world, don't they? Thanos wants to dominate the universe. That's what a villain does. He wants power and he wants control. So many of the superhero movies that I watch, they don't want power or control. They want unity and peace. And they work together. We have to get to this place where we begin to work together. See, John 13, 35, I don't have it up here. It says that the world will know that we are his disciples by the love that we have for one another. As we desire unity and teamwork, when we desire to put others first, when we desire to be self-sacrificing, when we desire to pursue after God, we begin to open up ourselves to see what we can do to bring about unity, to begin to bring about teamwork, to figure out how we can do this together. Because see, the Bible says that a kingdom divided against itself will fall. If you allow the enemy to come in there and begin to divide you, distract you, and bring in dissension and division, he has won the battle. When you watch all of these superhero movies, they always try to divide the team. The villain is always trying to attack. He's always trying to separate the unity, because if it's divided, he's got victory and he's got power. It's just like in Captain America's Civil War. That villain in that movie just wanted to get them at each other's throats to destroy each other. And that happens so much in the church, that we allow gossip, we allow criticism, we allow the enemy to come in here and divide us, because he knows that if the church is divided, if this person on this side is upset with this person on this side, it influences our testimony. It takes away our testimony. And see, the hero looks at that and says, no, I'm going to do my part to bring about unity, even if it means saying, I'm sorry. Even if it means admitting wrong, even though you may not have done wrong. It's being like Jesus, who was perfect, yet went to the cross for our sins. Why? Because he wanted unity. He wanted us to come together as one. That was a short one. Number five, a villain is weak where a hero is courageous. I put it this way, a villain is just a bully. Picking on the weakest link. Goes after the small. And that's where the superhero comes in and he defends the small. Define the word courageous as this. It's a mental or moral strength to venture, persevere, and withstand danger, fear, or difficulty. And I saw this quote. It says, courage doesn't mean that you don't get afraid. Courage is about not letting that fear take control of your life. A hero has to be courageous. A hero has to be willing in the midst of all the persecution, in the midst of all the difficulties, in the midst of giving so much of himself or herself, he still stands there because it's about the people. You ever watch them when life gets difficult in the movies? The villain is, what's the first thing the villain does? Takes off running. But a hero, when things get difficult, digs its feet in and it stands its ground. See, the Bible says that resist the devil and he will flee. Some of y'all need to understand that scripture. What that means is it says it's almost like a runner that is getting into, what do they call them things? The blocks. Getting into the blocks and they're digging their feet in. And they're not going to move. Some of you, when the enemy comes in there, you run away. You let him distract you and you let him scare you that you take off running. Where God says in his word, stand firm. Stand firm in your faith. Trust me. Understand I am with you. And the enemy has no power or authority. But you want to know why we run and we flee? Is because we have nothing to stand on because we're not studying the word. You have to be willing to get into the word. Every superhero trained. Every superhero did what was necessary to become the hero in the story. If you want to overcome the enemy, you have to do what is required to defeat the enemy. That's getting into the word. That's building relationships with people. Now see, I know this ain't normal preaching in America nowadays. We want to fluff you up and tell you God is good. Here's some money. Go have some fun. No, I'm telling you, there are souls. There are people that need to know the message of Jesus Christ. But because we're so afraid of the enemy, we're too busy running that we're not able to reach. Where God is saying, stand your ground, stand firm, resist him. He will be defeated and your world around you is going to see you living victoriously. And then all of a sudden they're going to go, wait a minute. Why is it they're able to do that? How is it that things are going so bad? How is it that this is going on or this is going on? Yet they're able to stand there and they're confident. What is that? And it will open up the door for you to say, let me tell you what it is. It's my God. It's my Savior. Because see, the Bible tells me that when I am weak, he is strong. In the midst of all of this, his presence is there with me, and there is a peace that passes all understanding. Telling you, I did a funeral for an 8-year-old last Saturday. That family was broken, but that mom and dad had a confidence in their baby girl. They had a hope. They had a peace that people were like, how are they? How are they still together? I don't know what I would do. But yet they stood there in full confidence of their God and understanding that he's in control. And when they were asked how, they said two things. One, I knew my baby girl loved Jesus Christ because I was there the day she got baptized. And number two, because of my relationship with the Father. We have to get to a place where our confidence allows us to stand firm on the things that we have read, the things that we have memorized, and the things that we have learned from the Word of God. It takes courage. It takes the willingness. And it takes a sidekick. Batman had Alfred. Superman had Lois Lane. Scooby-Doo had Shaggy. They all had a sidekick. They had somebody that stood with them when times were getting difficult. When they felt like giving up, they had somebody there. And let me tell you, your greatest sidekick is the Holy Spirit. It's calling out to Him. Bible says that Jesus went into heaven so He can send the Holy Spirit, who is a comforter. He is real, He is authentic, and He wants a relationship with you. That's the first sidekick. If you are married, your spouse is your second sidekick. He or she should be the very one that you are talking to, that you are studying the Word of God with, that you are worshiping with. Husbands, take the lead in your family and start doing devotions with your wife. I don't know what to do, Pastor Ronnie. All right. Go to 1 John chapter 1. Read 5 scriptures together. And then tell your baby, have a good day. And the next day, read the next 5. And the next day, the next 5. And then maybe 2 weeks from now, you say, hey, we're going to read 1 John chapter 2. And we're going to read the first 4 chapters. And what I like for us to do is write down our thoughts. And then maybe before we go to bed, we talk about what we thought that scripture meant. That's it. And I'm telling you, you start that simple principle within a year. You watch your marriage change. But you watch yourself grow in your relationship. And the things that you're writing down now, when you look at it a year from now, you'll go, wow, look at the growth. But God gave you a sidekick in your spouse. And then another sidekick is, I'm not going to get off of this kick, is life groups. Life groups, life groups. Relationships, relationships, relationships. When Jesus sent out the disciples, He sent them out 2 by 2. When you read everything in the scriptures, there was always 2. When you read the scripture, it talks about the power of 2 or more. The Bible says, where 2 or more are gathered in My name, I am there. And whatever you want, I got you. It's the RKB, that's the Ronnie Kobe version. There is power in a sidekick. There is power in having somebody come alongside you. The last thing that it takes, and this is part 1 of the sermon, but the next part is pretty quick, is a villain is dark, a hero is a light. When you look at the superhero movies, and like I told you, I've watched a ton of them, villains always operate in the dark. I understand when my daddy used to tell me, nothing good happens after midnight, son. It's the devil's playground. So many bad things happen at night. More importantly, associate dark with isolation. When you isolate yourself, you open the door to the enemy. When you close things off, when you hide things, you keep them in the closet, it becomes the devil's tool. When you allow your past to keep control of you instead of shedding light on it, it becomes the tool of the enemy. But the Bible tells us in Matthew that we are the light of the world. We are the city on a hill that should not be hidden. We should let our light shine before all men, all women, everybody, everywhere we go. Doesn't mean, Ronnie, I walk around with a flashlight. No, what it means is you just walk around with the love of Jesus Christ. Walk in His peace, walk in His understanding, and just be a vessel that He uses. Be a vessel that is open to anything and everything. See, the question you have to ask yourself this morning is, what kind of example are you setting to the world? I always tell people, you're doing one of 2 things. You're either pointing people to the cross or you're pointing them away. That's the reality of the life. When we call ourselves or Christians, we're told to go into all the world and make disciples. So every day I'm trying to ask myself, am I pointing people to the cross with my actions or am I pushing them away? Am I being the villain to their story or am I being the hero? See, I desire to be a light. But I'm a messed up person. It's probably why I love the Incredible Hulk so much. The Incredible Hulk is classified as a hero. Yet the Hulk becomes the Hulk because he loses his temper. But if you ever read the comic books, you recognize one thing about Bruce Banner is he always recognizes his failures. He never tries to overshadow them. He never tries to minimize them. He doesn't try to manipulate them. He says, this is my problem. I'm telling you, you'll be the greatest testimony in the world when you begin to own up to your mistakes and you begin to say, this is who I am, but I got a Savior who loves me the way that I am. And as you see the Incredible Hulk over the years, he's becoming more and more of an asset. Why? Because of all the sidekicks. And you can't beat the Incredible Hulk. He's just awesome. But the reality is this. So many times we think we have to be perfect in order for our light to shine. Nah, what I've learned about this is that my life is a mess. My life is dirty, it's muddy, but there's Jesus in there. And what I've learned is when I give him the dirt and I give him the mud, that little light that's inside of me becomes magnified through his presence and through his glory. See, Romans 8 says that he will work all things for the good for those that love him and are called into his purpose. In other words, he will take all of that mess, all of that dirty, if you give it to him and you go after him, he's going to use it for his good and for his glory. But we have to begin to be willing to walk in that light. And again, it's about being surrounded. Now, we're going to watch a quick video, and then I'm going to preach sermon number two, but I promise you it's quick. It's only two pages. So roll that bean footage.
I put the pants in the box, Mrs. Parker.
Thank you, Henry.
Hi, Peter.
Hey, Henry. You're getting tall.
Henry, why don't you put those cookbooks in with the mixer?
Okay. You take Spider-Man's pictures, right?
I used to.
Where is he?
Henry and I agree. We don't see his picture in the paper anymore.
He, quit.
Why?
Wanted to try other things.
He'll be back, right?
I don't know.
You'll never guess who he wants to be. Spider-Man.
Why?
Well, he knows a hero when he sees one. Too few characters out there flying around like that, saving old girls like me. And Lord knows, kids like Henry need a hero. Courageous, self-sacrificing people, setting examples for all of us. Everybody loves a hero. People line up for them, cheer them, scream their names, and years later they'll tell how they stood in the rain for hours just to get a glimpse of the one who taught him to hold on a second longer. I believe there's a hero in all of us that keeps us honest, gives us strength, makes us noble, and finally allows us to die with pride, even though sometimes we have to be steady and give up the thing we want the most. Even our dreams. Spider-Man did that for Henry, and he wonders where he's gone. He needs him.
Do you think you could lift that desk and put it into the garage for me?
As that was playing, I'm praying that you were hearing the spiritual implications. And so we're going to look at that. If you can go back to the PowerPoint, guys. The world needs a hero. The world needs somebody to show them that there is victory. There is a world that needs to know who Jesus Christ is. And so I want to look at the lessons that Aunt May taught. And I told you it's going to be real quick, 6 points. First thing is, they know a hero when they see one. She said, Henry knows a hero. Everybody knows a hero. My question to you this morning, do people know that you are a Christian? Do people know that you love Jesus Christ? Do people know that you have given him your life? Or is your life about being a hero on Sunday mornings? See, the world knows a Christian. A world knows somebody who is real in their relationship with Christ. And I think sometimes we don't share Christ, that we're not the hero that we need to be because we know the hypocrisy. See, there's a difference between making mistakes and being a hypocrite. See, we all fail, like I said, with the Incredible Hulk. See, the hypocrite is the one that doesn't want to act like they make mistakes, but they want to personify Jesus. See, the world will know that you're a hero. People will know that you're the hero that this world needs. And people will know that you walk in the power of Jesus Christ by what I said earlier, by the love that you have for one another. Second lesson is, the world is looking for a hero. I'm telling you something. People may mock you for your faith. People may laugh at you for your faith. People may not want nothing to do with your faith. Well, I'm going to tell you something. They're looking for something in the world, and you have the very answer that they need. See, we have these God-sized holes in our heart, and I know that sounds cliche because it's been said so many times, but there is only a spot that God can fill. But we go through our lives trying to fill it with so much other things. We fill it through unhealthy relationships. We pursue it through alcohol or pornography or this or that or all of these other things, where what the world needs is the truth about Jesus Christ. They need you to be the hero. They need you to be the Christian that you know that you can be. They need you to be the one that is willing to take a stand and say Jesus loves you. Be willing to hold your ground in the midst of all of that. Third lesson is that the world needs a hero. It needs Jesus Christ. It needs to know that he is real. Everyone loves a hero. I said earlier that the world will despise you. The world will turn against you. Just like in every superhero movie. They despise Batman. They turned against Superman. I always turn against the Hulk. They didn't like Wolverine. But in the end, they recognized the good because the hero never gave up on them. That's what the world needs to see. They need to see that even when your friends turn against you, when the world doesn't want to hear what you have to say, that you don't give up. Think about Jesus when he was standing before the people, the Sadducees, and he was standing before the court, and he had earlier told Peter that he was going to deny him. Jesus heard every aspect of that. And when the rooster crowed after the third denial, they locked eyes. It could have been real easy for Jesus to say, why am I even doing this? The closest one, the closest disciple has turned his back against me. He didn't. He still went to the cross. What I'm telling you this morning is that in the end, they may not like you now, but they're going to love you in the long run when you never give up on them. The fifth thing is that there's a hero inside all of us. If you notice, every superhero had a disguise. They hid. Batman was Bruce Wayne. Superman, Clark Kent. Peter Parker, Spider-Man. Tony Stark, Iron Man. Bruce Banner, Hulk. There's a hero that lies inside each and every person that is in this room. Aunt May said it best. You are a hero. You are going to save somebody. You are going to be used for great things. You are the one that God has called. Let me tell you, God doesn't need us, but he wants us. He wants you to be a part of the family. He wants you to use you. He wants you to be a part. He wants you to serve, because when you do, it's why I cry like a baby when I see him run to the baptism, when I see him run to the altar, because I know that I was a part of that. And there is a joy, there is a peace that says it was worth it. See, there is a hero that lies inside of you. There is untapped potential. There is untapped God. There is an untapped purpose. And he's saying, stop hiding it. Stop disguising it. Let that hero come out. Be what he has called you to be. Love the way that he has called you to love. Overcome these villains. Stand firm in your faith. Defeat the enemy. Because he has something for you. And the last thing that Aunt May said is, where has Spider-Man gone? There are times that I look at the world that we live in and I say, where have Christians gone? We button up our shirts. We hide our Bibles. And I'm telling you, I believe that God wants to unleash the hero inside of you. He wants you to step out into faith. He wants you to not be concerned about the physical, but begin to focus on the spiritual. See, one of the things that God did for me about 6 months ago
because I'm a fleshy person. Sometimes I look at and I go, God, the church isn't growing. And I get caught up on numbers. But this is what I've learned. I don't care how many people there are. If there's one empty seat, there's room for one more. I've got to be the hero that God has called me to be. I got to serve the way that God has called me to serve. I got to love the way that God has called me to love. I got to forgive the way that God has forgiven. And that's how I want to end this series, if you stand with me. Find the hero again in your life. Reignite that passion. The worship team is going to sing this. Jermaine, kill the lights for me. We're going to sing, Holy Spirit, You're Welcome Here. And as I said earlier, when you allow yourself to get into the presence of God, life change happens. Moses got into the presence of God and his life changed forever. Saul became Paul when he became into the presence of God. Fishermen became mighty men of God when they got into the presence of God. Women became mighty when they got into the presence of God. So this morning I want to end just like this. Every eye closed. Talk to your God. Ask Him, how can I be the hero that You've called me to be, God? Maybe husbands, it's how can I be the hero to my family? How can I be the hero at work? We're just going to spend a few minutes in worship. And I want you to just ask Him. Maybe you're there, here this morning and you don't know Jesus Christ. Let me tell you, my friend, it's the greatest decision I ever made. Doesn't mean my life got so much easier. It just means I had somebody to help me in the trying times. And I want to encourage you to start that journey. They're going to sing and I'll come up and dismiss. If you need prayer, we have some people up here that'll pray for you. If you need to just get it to the altar, get at the altar. But I want you to discover that you're a hero. That God died for you. That you can be the hero for somebody else.
Please.
just ask you this morning, God, that we would just fall in love with your presence again. That, God, that we would desire to know you, to not just know about you, to just only be settled for what we have read in a book, God, but that it would become alive. Lord, the word talks about that it's alive and it's active. So God, I pray that we would fall in love with your presence again, that we would fall in love with your word again, that we would fall in love with relationships again. Because Lord, the world is looking for a hero. It's looking for an answer, God. And they're searching in all the wrong places, yet we sit on the truth. That God, I pray that we would overcome the villain of fear, and that we would step in the victory that you have for us, and that we would let our light shine before all men. That we would be filled with humility, that we would be filled with love, grace and mercy and forgiveness for the world that is around us. That God, that we would become a testimony of your power and of your presence. And God, I truly am asking that, Lord, we came in here with an expectation of leaving different than the way that we came. That God, that we walk out of this place not just hearing a message and going, that was great, he ripped his shirt. But Lord, that we'd walk out of here saying, nah, let me rip that flesh and let my Jesus shine for the world to see. Lord, that we would be the testimony, that we'd be the hope, that we'd be the anchor that people need, and that we would be available to share our story. The story of how we became a hero, and share the story on how they too can become a hero. And God, we pray for all of the men and women overseas, God, Lord, protect them. Bring them home to their loved ones, Father God. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week. We are starting a young adults life group at my house. So if you're 18 to 29 and you're single, come see me. I'll give you my address.
Good morning and welcome to Calvary Church. Thanks for joining us this Sunday. We're excited you're here. Let's see what's on the calendar. Ladies, don't forget about your Decades and Dice event next Saturday right here at Calvary Church. Show up with a costume from your favorite decade and a finger food to share. I'm so excited about our next refuel. It's August 4th right here from 6 to 7:30. If you don't know what refuel is, it's just a night of worship. We got a huge thank you to everyone who supported the Royal Rangers Cardboard Regatta with pads, life jackets. It was a great event. We had 6 boats in the water. Again, thank you. They had a great time. If you want to get connected to what's going on right here at Calvary Church, stop by one of our social media outlets, whether it's our website, our Facebook, or our live stream, which we broadcast every one of our services every week.